I'm a principal engineer at Just Eat, and we are the number one in the food delivery business in the UK, and as well as in a few other countries in the Europe. But I don't think we have any presence in Poland at all, so you probably have no idea who we are. So in my current job, as well as my last job, I work very closely with Amazon Web Services, where I've actually used, I've worked very closely with a number of different services that they provide, which has given me a nice insight into some of the complexities and challenges that arise when you try to integrate with some of these services. Complexities of three common types. Under abstraction, whereby the library and tooling available to you doesn't provide a sufficient level of abstraction to make working with the service easy and seamless. Or maybe the service itself is too simple and end up having to push some of the complexities to you as the consumer of the service. Or perhaps the API just wasn't designed to support some of the more advanced use patterns and user needs that arise from in the wild. We use three of the APIs that I worked with in my previous role, and I hope as case study, and hopefully give you some inspiration on how to identify these complexities when you encounter them, and how you can use simple DSLs to tackle those complexities. Along the way, we will have a look at F# and how you can be a very effective weapon in writing these DSLs, be it internal DSLs, which is just really just an API that speaks the language from your domain, or it could be external DSLs, which are usually in strings, so require some parsing. We'll start with DynamoDB, which is the fastest growing service that Amazon has to offer. It is a managed key value store with a built-in redundancy and 99s guarantees. Everything runs on SSD, so you get great performance and very consistent performance as well, typically in the single-digit millisecond range for reads and writes. Unlike most other services that Amazon provides, it's not a pay-as-you-go model. Instead, you just name the throughput you require for a table. So it's the same for me, it's the same amount of work for me to have a database table that can support 10 reads and writes a second, as it is for me to get a table that can do 10,000 reads and writes a second. I just fill in a very small form and then press OK. And a few minutes later, my table will be ready for me. And of course, I can change my throughput requirements as and when it's appropriate, and I only pay for the amount of resources that Amazon has reserved in order to meet my throughput requirements. So you can have a database that can be infinitely scalable, but instead of not paying for the amount of throughput that you require for the amount of time that you require them. It does allow you to do some very interesting things. One of the case studies that they published very early on is how an advertising agency, which pretty much does nothing, no traffic all year round, except for the 4 hours of Super Bowl, during which they get something around the range of 1.2 million hits a second. So instead of having to build a very expensive and capable infrastructure to support that kind of peak load and not use it for 99% of the time, they can just scale up the database throughput all the way through the ceiling during the 4 hours of Super Bowl, and then once that's done, you can scale it all the way back down, and they're able to do this for a few thousand dollars. It's a semi-schema database, so therefore each of the rows in the data rows you have in the table, you need to specify a hash key, which determines the partitioning of the data on the physical machines. You can also optionally specify a range key, which allows you to run a query against your data. And a query in DynamoDB, so terminology, means you specify a hash key, and then you specify some conditional filters on the range key. Or you can use one of the two indices. You can use a local secondary index, which gives you an alternative range key on your table, or you can use a global secondary index, which allows you to specify an alternative pair of hash and range key. So as an example here, I've got a table that tracks the player's score in different games. Most of the time, I'll be working against the particular players, and so I'll put the hash key on the user ID and the range key on the game title. But sometimes I want to be able to sort and get data based on the top score the player has. So for example, if I want to find out the top 5 games for this particular player, I'll use that local secondary index. This doesn't help me when I want to ask questions for a particular game. For example, who are the top players in the Donkey Kong, for example. In that case, that's why I will put a global secondary index and use the game title as my alternative hash key and a top score as my alternative range key. You can also do full table scans in DynamoDB, but it has it's not very fast for starters, but it also consumes a lot of your read throughput, and it may impact your other operations that you're doing against the database at the same time. That said, it's a lovely database. That's in the last 5 years I've used it, it's only gone down once, which compared to most other systems I've used, it's very good. And it also alleviates me from all these concerns I normally have around the performance and scalability of my database solutions. However, when it comes to the query and scan APIs, it's actually really complicated because there's so many different options and tweaks. And you can see that just judging by the size of the documentation, when you have something that requires so much text to explain what it does and how to use it, you have quite a lot of complexity that you're dealing with here. And if I want to ask from my table earlier, who are the top three players in Starship X with a score of at least 1,000, I end up writing quite a bit of code. Is this legible for the guys at the back? Yep, okay. So I start by creating some query request object. I set a few properties to say what table name and what index to use. And then to express my filters, I have to create these condition objects, and then I have to attach those attribute value objects and so on and so forth. I mean, it's not a lot of code, but the thing here is that my intention, the question I'm trying to ask, I don't have an abstraction that allows me to express them sufficiently and easily so that someone who comes into this code can easily understand what was the question that I had in mind in the first place. And wouldn't it be nice if I can write something like this instead? It's very similar to SQL and something that most of the developers are familiar with already. And it's also a lot shorter as well, which is why I decided to went ahead and wrote it to a library called DynamoDB.SQL with the goal of disguising some of the complexities that's associated with the query and scan APIs, and also to help me prevent some of the abstraction leaks, because often when you've got an abstraction that's very complicated itself, you just end up using, rather than wrapping around it, you just end up using what Amazon provides you through the SDK, which is what happened in my last job. And another goal was to allow you to write, express your queries and your questions in a SQLite syntax, which is familiar to most developers. To do that, you take a query in a string format, you pass it into abstract syntax tree, which is then I can use to convert it into a request object I can actually use to execute against DynamoDB. And for this project, I decided to go with fparsec, which is the F# port of the parser library from Haskell, and describes itself as a parser combinator library. And if that sounds confusing to you, all it means is that you build complex parsers out of simple parsers and compose them together. And the function that you use to compose these different parsers, that's what is called a combinator. So with a simplified example, we want to be able to take this simple query and turn it into an abstract syntax tree. And we can start by dissecting the query into separate components. You've got some keywords, select and from. You've got table name. And you also have a way to specify either a star, which is say select all, or provide a comma separated list of attribute names. And for this, we can represent it as using a union type. Is everyone familiar with this syntax here? Anyone? Okay, anyone wants me to explain what is happening here? Okay, so have you seen the enums in the Java or C#?
Yeah.
So think of this as enums, but more powerful version where each of the cases can be associated with an arbitrary set of types. In this case, I'm saying that an attribute, the type, can be either asterisk, which is just, it just itself, or it can be an attribute which is associated with an array of strings. So those would be the comma-separated list of attribute names. And for the whole query, I can represent it using a simple record type, which you can think of as a lightweight class where the fields are immutable. So I'll start by writing a parser for the select keyword. In this case, I can use one of the built-in parsers from fparsec called the skipStringCI, which will match the string that I've given it in a case-insensitive way, and it just ignores it. It matches it, says, okay, it's matched, but it doesn't give me any useful return value. And I can do the same thing to write a parser for the from keyword. And as for the table name, I know from the spec that DynamoDB requires table names to only have letters and digits. So I can do that by I can start by building a simple predicate using the built-in predicates functions is letter and is digit, and compose the two of them together using a custom combinator which combines two predicates together with all semantic. And to build a parser for a table name, then I can use the many ones satisfy. In this case, it will create a parser that will pass a sequence of one or more characters that satisfies my predicate function. And for the attributes list, we know we have two different cases here, a star or a comma separated list of attribute names. And for the star, I can use a string CR return parser, which when it's matched, when it matches the string that I've given it, similar to the skip string CR we saw earlier, but the only difference here is that you actually return a value that I provided. And remember from the previous slide where we got attributes is either asterisks or attribute with a comma separated list of strings. So in this case, where it matches the star, it will return that particular case. And for the comma separated list of attribute names, we first need to have a parser that can parse the individual attribute names. And in this case, it has the same requirements that the characters have to be either digits or is letters. So our implementation is very similar to what we did with the table name parser. And before we can move on, we also need a parser for the comma. So we, again, use a skip string CI to build a parser for the comma. And now that we have both of these guys, it's time to combine them again, using the sep by one parser combinator, which will pass one or more attribute names separated by comma using the corresponding parsers that we've built up so far. So now we have the parser for our star and a parser for a comma separated list of attribute names. It's time to combine them again, this time using the choice combinator, which you can use the shorthand notation to express. So what this guy is going to do is that it's going to try to pass the input using the first parser, and if that fails, then you will try to attempt to pass the input with the second parser I provided. And that is the last parser we need in order to pass the query that we've got here. And the last thing we need to do is compose the four of them together, and this time we use the tuple 4 combinator, which takes four parsers and try to match your input using these four parsers in that order, and you will return a tuple of four elements using the return values from your parsers. But in this case, we don't really want to be working with a tuple. Instead, what we could do is we can forward it onto another mapper function, which will ignore the keyword select and from, and just extract the attributes and table names and construct a query object that we specified earlier. And that is how I can create a parser for a simple query like this. Of course, I can then incrementally add support for where clauses and order by and limit and with. And once I've got a number of some basic parsers, I was able to write a parser for the whole query syntax in the DynamoDB with less than 50 lines of code, which just goes to show how much productivity you can get from using F# and Fparsec when it comes to creating parsers. But there are cases where you don't want to take, using Fparsec, you need to take a dependency for a package in .NET. Sometimes you don't want to do that, or you can't do that. So for example, if you're writing your type provider in F#, and which is why Michael Newton created a little project called the mParsec, which gives you a very similar API, but it has one single file. So if you want to, you can either depend on it through a packet, or you can just take a copy of it, put it into your project. So to recap, we looked at how DynamoDB's query and scan operations can be quite complicated, and as an example of an API that suffers from under-abstraction, and how you, at least with the .NET libraries that you provide it with, and how you can use a simple DSL to allow you to hide those complexity and be able to express your questions, your queries in a language that's much more expressive of your intent. Before I move on, is there any questions about this so far? Okay, no question, great. So moving on to another service called the Amazon Simple Workflow, which is an orchestration workflow service that helps you manage the state of a particular workflow and give you support for retrying and monitoring, et cetera, et cetera. And the way it works is that you write your own decision workers and you will poll the service for work. And when you get back is what is called decision task, which contains the current state of the workflow, as well as the event that's occurred so far. And then with that, your decision worker is supposed to decide what happens next in this workflow. So as an example, if you've got a payment processing system and the whole sort of payment processing pipeline, that can be considered as a workflow whereby you talk to some, I don't know, some third-party API, and then based on result, you maybe send some email, you maybe do some other work, but it's a well-defined pipeline, number of different steps that we want to perform. So your decision worker would be polling for the event and see, okay, has email been sent? If so, then I'll move the workflow to do the next step, which would be to perform a task to, talk to some other API, for example. But that means the decision worker itself is not doing any useful work itself. It's just orchestrating what happens next in the workflow, which is why you need to also write an activity worker, which also posts the service for task, but the task it gets back is slightly different. The task it gets back contains the payload, which tells you the activity worker how to do the activity that it's supposed to do. So for example, it may contain the user's credit card information or the URL for the service that it needs to talk to or the email address that the activity worker needs to send email to, for example. And once it's done its job, it will report back to the service that the activity has been completed. And because you can deploy your workers anywhere, it means you can have a mix of some of your workers in being hosted in EC2, some of it being hosted on premises or even from your laptop. And there's a management console where you can go and see the current state as well as all the events and activity that's been performed on that particular workflow. So at the time I was evaluating this service to orchestrate the ETA process that we had in my last job, whereby every night, so I was in gaming before, where we had something like 1 million daily active users with a lot of requests happening against our backend services. And every night we got this ETL process where we need to first scale up our sort of our queue processing cluster of machines, and then we have to list all the analytics events that's been recorded and stored in S3, and then do a bunch of aggregation and processing before we then ship everything from S3 to Google Cloud Storage so that we can then load it into Google BigQuery, which is the BI and the analytics solution that we use, which is a very lovely service, by the way, except that we have to do this data shipping process overnight. And we want to do something, we want to use something that Amazon is offering as a service. So as part of my evaluation process, I thought, let me write a very simple Hello World example, a Hello World workflow. And I was slightly dismayed by the amount of code I ended up writing, which is pretty insane. And the sad thing is that even though I've written a lot of code, I haven't even handled things like error handling and retries and heartbeats. And mostly, my intention, my very simple Hello World workflow is just lost in the noise. So after I've gone back and sort of thought about what happened, I realized that when I'm trying to build an application on top of the simple workflow service, you've got a very thin layer of the service API. But beneath all of that is a number of recurring concerns that you have to take care of as a consumer of the service, including polling, heartbeat, and error handling. And after all, you've done all of that, you still have to write your decision workers and your activity workers. So that's a lot of plumbing and a lot of infrastructure to implement just to get going. And the only thing that's unique to a particular instance or workflow that you have is the activities, the things that you need to do as part of this workflow. Everything else, including the decision worker, is just glorified boilerplate. And this actually reminds me of something that Chris Jordan wrote a little while back in a post called The Complexity of Simplicity, whereby he was talking about how you can have good and bad simplicity, where good simplicity allows you to do more with less through using leverage, and bad simplicity is being able to do less with less. And he gave the example of how Google hides all the complexity around searching, We have a very simple text box where you can search all kinds of different things, the current exchange rate, how much euro I get for £5, or the current weather in China. There's all kinds of things you can do with this very simple text box. And that's what some of the guys at Stripe has done with credit card processing, for example. It's a very nice post. I've got a link on the slides which I'll share afterwards. I do recommend you to go and read it afterwards if you haven't already. So back to the example I showed you earlier. Even though I wrote a lot of code, this is probably the most important part. And this is the decision worker logic that determines, okay, based on the last event I can see that happened on this workflow, if the activity was completed, then I'll complete the workflow. If it failed, then I'll fail the workflow, et cetera, et cetera. But looking at this code, I have no way of mapping it back to the workflow that I actually had in mind. There's no way for me to translate, or to easily translate this code into this image that I had in my head when I first started writing things. And that's because the workflow itself is implied by the logic in your decision worker. But instead, wouldn't it be nice if the workflow is made explicit, and instead of being implied, it would drive the logic you have in your decision worker? And wouldn't it be even nicer if instead of driving, it would just automate it? And that's why I sat down one weekend and wrote it into the library so that I can do just that. And with the goal of removing all this boilerplate code that I have to write normally when I try to work with the service, and allows me to write code that actually matches how I think about workflow. So if you go back to the example of a Hello World workflow I had in mind, this is what I can do with the internal API that I created, where you just create a bunch of metadata around around your workflow, as well as the activity that you're trying to perform, a number of different timeout settings, and then you just attach the activity to the workflow using this very simple operator. So now when I'm trying to understand what this workflow is doing, I just have to follow the arrow. And since your activity really is just a glorified way to call some function, some lambda, so that's our that's the thing that we are doing, and our activity metadata is just links it to that particular lambda. Workflows can be nested, and that is a feature that the service offers as well, so that you can have a parent workflow that kicks off some other child workflow, do some other stuff, and when it's done, continue on from the parent. And we can support that in this DSL as well, whereby here I have defined, declare a child workflow on the top, and I can attach it to a parent workflow in the same way that I can attach activities to the workflow. And the library also handles the propagation of input to output. So if you start the workflow with some input, it gets passed on as input to the first activity, whose result, whose return value is then passed on to as input to the next activity. And the same works with child workflows as well. And the result from your last activity would be the result for your whole workflow. And you can also support, retries. And if there's any exceptions, then the exception will be captured and reported back to the service so that you can see that in the Amazon Management Console. So to recap, we looked at how a simple workflow as an example of an API that's too simple for its own good and ended up pushing some of the complexities to you as a consumer, and how you can use a very simple DSL, again, to help you remove all the boilerplate and support visual thinking when you are coding and writing your workflow. So we move on to the last example I have to show, which is the Amazon CloudWatch service. It's a monitoring service that collects and publishes metrics around your EC2 services or DynamoDB. So this is where you can then go and see the CPU usage or the network in and out for your instances, for example. You can also publish and collect metrics from your application. So if your application, for example, in my last place where we would use PostShop, so we use aspect-only programming to instrument all the methods where it's either doing some CPU work, or heavy CPU work, or it's doing I/O, or it's the service entry point. So where I've got a web API, every single method that's the entry point of my service would be recording how much time it's taken and report it back to CloudWatch. And you can then use the management console to view your metrics and compose them together and so on. It's really a fundamental and very important service in the Amazon Web Services ecosystem, but it has a lot of shortcomings. For example, from the UI, you can only limits you to 200 metrics. So once you get to a certain size, you got a lot, so many metrics. Unless you know what you're looking for, you have no chance of being able to discover what other things are there, which makes finding things, new problems, and debugging new problems very difficult. And there's also no support built-in way to find correlation between services, between metrics. So if your payment system was slow last night because the database was so slow, now it's down to you to go and dig around or find as many metrics as you can to find that correlation to prove that the payment service latency was up because the database that it depends on also has a latency issue at the same time. So it renders a routine postmortem investigation into an exercise of finding a needle in a haystack. So having suffered a lot of pain and driven by anger, I decided to again write a simple DSL, which allows me to write queries for example, if I want to find the metrics whose 5-minute average was longer than 1 second any time in the last 12 hours, I can now express it as a query that's using the internal DSL, which is fairly human and readable, where unit is millisecond and average is greater than 1,000 over the last 12 hours at an interval of 5 minutes. So this will go and look for all the metrics in the last 12 hours and look at the 5-minute data points and find anything whose average is more than a second. Or I can use the external DSL and express it in pretty much a similar way. So now if I want to say the end of my cache nodes had a CPU spike yesterday, I can express it using this DSL, and it supports regex as well. So every metric in the CloudWatch will have a namespace that it falls under, as well as a name, as well as different dimensions. So you can have a CPU metric for your Redis cluster, and there will be different dimensions, one for each of the nodes in the cluster. And in all in all, there's only about 15 different cases you can use, because based on the capabilities that you have with CloudWatch. And for this particular project, I decided to not use fparsec and just write parsers using a feature in F# called Active Patterns. Still not a lot of code, and we'll look at some of the details later. So this is the example query that you can write in this DSL, and you can dissect it into three parts. You've got a bunch of filters which helps you identify to find the metrics you're looking for, and you've got a time frame that tells you how far back you want to look at, and you can specify what granularity of data points you're looking at. And we can express the three different parts in the type like we did before, and we can get the same type from both the internal as well as external DSL, which I can then turn into requests I can make against the CloudWatch service. Here, I know we want to build a filter against the metric name and metric namespace, so I can declare a few types that represents a metric term, which is either namespace or name. And in this case, I have a filter type, which can be, in this case, the first case would be a filtering by the namespace or the name of a metric with some predicate function. We also know that we want to filter by unit. So we just add another case to my filter type here, which will filter by using another Boolean, predicate function against the name of the unit, and so on and so forth, where we can filter by stats. And we know we want to compose different filters together, so the easy way to do that would be to make the filter type recursive. So we can have a composite filter, which is just, this is how you specify a tuple in F#, by the way, using the star. Here I'm saying that I've got a composite filter case, which is, takes a tuple of two filters and just combines two of them together. And for the time frame, I want to support the last 5 days, last 3 minutes, and so on, or any time since given daytime, or anything that's between two daytime, and so on. This is a very simple model that captures all the information that we want to remember in order to make a request against the CloudWatch. And for I guess many of you are probably not familiar with F#, so here's just a quick primer on the active patterns, which is a feature that I've used to build this parser. Active pattern is a feature that allows you to abstract patterns into named functions so that you can easily reuse and compose them when you're doing pattern matching. Of three common types, single case pattern works similar to a normal function, except in this case, you're putting the name of the pattern in this what we call banana clip operators. So this is a pattern that takes a string as input and returns a float as output. So when I do pattern matching now, I can pattern match something, and the thing that I'm pattern matching against becomes the input to my pattern, and the output from my pattern is then goes in this space here, which I can either provide a literal value so that in this case, part of my pattern is to say, okay, if I was able to pass this thing, whatever input that is, as a string, as number 42, then this case will be matched, and this bit of code will be run. Otherwise, you would try the next line, or you can even bound the output value into a local variable, which can then use in the rest of your code on the right-hand side of this arrow. But because in our pattern here, if anything that doesn't pass as a float, we throw exceptions. So it doesn't handle unexpected inputs very well, which is why you also have partial patterns, which allows you to handle these unexpected cases a lot better. Here, I've got a very similar pattern to what we had before. The difference is that instead of returning a float, we're returning a float option, which is the F# equivalent to the maybe type in the Haskell. So now, where we've got an invalid input, none of these cases will match, which is why we have this catch-all clause at the bottom here. And the very last type of, active pattern you can have is a multi-case pattern where, given some input, you can imagine if you implicitly declare some union type with the different cases that you can turn that, you can map that input type into. So where's the prime, I'll return the prime case with the float, and if it's not a prime or not a number, and so on and so forth. So now when I'm doing pattern matching with this, I can do the same thing I did before. But what you can also do is you can compose different patterns together in the same match case using the AND or semantic, or you can even nest different patterns. So we know that when the prime pattern is matched, this is a float, and we can apply another active pattern that works against a float to check whether or not it's a palindrome. So this is a very easy way for me to say that if some string represents a prime number that is also a palindrome, then that is a power prime, which you would know if you do a lot of Project Euler challenges. So that's a very quick primer on active pattern and how it works. Let's see how we can use it to build parsers with. So given the example I showed you earlier, the first thing I want to do is I want to take that string and tokenize it into a list of strings. And a list in F# is written in other functional languages as well. They are a linked list, so where every item in the list contains a value as well as pointer to the rest of the list. And you can construct the list in F# using the const operator, which is really just prepending an item to the rest of the list, and so on and so forth. But you can also use it in pattern matching. It allows you to pattern match against the structure of a list in F# using that const notation. So now, I can use active patterns to write simple parsers for that will match your string in a case-insensitive way, or a float. Or you can have active patterns that match against empty strings or any string that starts and ends with some particular character. And now I can compose them together to do more and more interesting things. For example, I can start building a parser for a quoted string, which is anything that starts with a single quote and ends with a single quote. And when this is matched, I will return the string that's in between the single quotes, which I can use Then in my patent to match to active patent to match the my list of tokens by inspecting my list of patents. So once we've turned this query, tokenized this query into a list of strings, we can use this patent, this active patent to match the inspect the first two elements and apply a different patent to each of these elements in this case, and we capture the rest of the tokens into local into a variable called the TL for short for tail. And then once that's matched, we will have captured the namespace that's been that's included in the single quote. We can then use that to construct an instance of the metric filter that we declared earlier. And it's also important for us then to return with the metric filter as well the rest of the tokens that we haven't matched against. So that allows us to recursively apply different patterns against the list token. And each of these active patterns would return a filter as well as the rest of the token. So then you can inspect if the rest of the tokens start with an end, then we will recurse, but prepend the filter that we pass out into the current accumulator so that in the next iteration, the accumulator is growing. And when we don't see the end in the rest of the tokens, then we just flatten everything out so that we have, in this case, because the filter type has the composite filter case, so we can take a whole bunch of a list of filters and just gradually turn them into composite filters. So you can apply this, and this whole thing returns the rest of the tokens as well, which you can then use to pass the time frame as well as the granularity for the metrics that you're looking for. So you can then compose everything together by taking an input, tokenizing it, pass a filter, which returns one composite filter with the rest of the tokens, which you then pass on to the other parser functions you have. So it's as you can probably see from the code examples, it's a bit more verbose. You end up doing a bit more work yourself, but it's still quite easy to do something yourself without having to make any dependencies on the libraries and libraries. The downside is that there's no built-in parsers for even the basic things like strings and floats, which means you have to do those yourself. So you have to do. If I have to do this work again, I'll probably just use the mparsec, which gives me one single file dependency and give me an API similar to fparsec. With the internal DSL, we can use it from anywhere where we can run F# code. With the external DSL, I also just packaged it into a command line interface tool that you can download from Chocolati, which allows you to write queries in the DSL syntax, and this would, because of the way the API design is not designed to support this kind of workflow, so I actually have to make several different requests against CloudWatch service. The first to list all the metrics just by its name, so that I can apply the first level of filters against the metrics and name, and then grab the stats and then apply filters that are filtering on the stats points and so on. Which is why I needed this library so that my work becomes easier. I don't have to do all this work manually every single time. So to recap, we look at the CloudWatch service as an example of a service where its impedance mismatch renders routine post-mortem investigation into an exercise of finding a needle in a haystack, and how you can use a simple DSL to at least make that needle a little bit easier to find. And so that's it. That concludes our little case study and how awesome F# is. Since my company is paying for my travel and stay, so I have to say that we are hiring, and we are in London. And with that, thank you very much for your time.
How many questions do we have? Okay, then.
If no question, then let's go ahead.
I have one.
Coffee.
How similar is the API or the DSL that you built for Amazon Workflow?
You right.
To Google's Dataflow.
To Google.
Google Dataflow.
I haven't used Dataflow myself, so I don't know.
Okay.
But the simple workflow service itself for us, we always prefer service that's been provided for us. Mm-hmm. And obviously, everything that we were running was already in Amazon, so it makes it a lot easier to use something that's also available in AWS. Right. When they launched the service, they also provided SDK for Java, which has got a different, a higher level abstraction rather than just a mapping to the actual service, the RESTful endpoints. And all the documentation refers to this is how you should build stuff on top of simple workflow service. You declare this and that and that, but everything refers to SDK's feature that's only available in Java. I believe that's still the case even today, 2 years after two, 3 years after the service has been around. So which is where we have to do some of this work myself to make life easier for me to use it from a .NET. But we got some guys using Google services, and they probably use Dataflow. What's the name of the service?
Google Dataflow. It's Google sort of Dataflow.
Right.
Data together, filters and things like that.
But is that just for moving data around?
Mostly.
Okay. There's something similar in the Amazon as well. It's called Data Pipeline, where this is workflow is run for more running arbitrary workloads, because it's whatever logic that you have in your activity worker.
Right. I see. Okay, can we applaud Yan one more time?